Welcome back, folks. Today's video is a bit of an archived piece of history that hasn't seen much light in terms of development in recent days. It all started in 94-95 when the PlayStation 1 retailed for $299, and 10 years later 100 million units were sold, making it one of the greatest consoles of all time. So what's so interesting about this console, aside from it being awesome and full of great memories? The PSX featured an R3000A CPU. Now the R3000A is a 32-bit RISC processor that uses the MIPS architecture. So MIPS is a computer platform that was obtained by SGI in 92 and is a RISC architecture that is able to do 500 million instructions per second at a staggering 33.8 megahertz, and you had 2 megabytes of EDO RAM, 1 megabyte of video RAM, and although it was nothing to get excited about, it still had the computing power to deliver great graphics. MIPS for the time had an impressive floating point capability, which made dealing with 3D graphics amazing compared to the x86 platform, for example. It was so good it was actually even part of the PlayStation 2, but functioning as an IOP, or an input-output processor for various models, depending on which model you had. You might have had the 33.8 or the 37.5 configuration. Later on, this was changed to a PowerPC 405-based Deckard IOP with 4 megabytes SD RAM, which emulated the R3000 for the PS2. The MIPS architecture was primarily being used for the small instruction set and the 5-stage pipeline, which is really good for embedded systems, and you could push the R3000 up to 40 megahertz back in 1989. The R3000 is technically a redesign of the R2000 that allowed for a greater clock speed. The Nintendo 64 actually uses an R4300i MIPS CPU and is capable of running the latest Linux kernel, as far as I last read. So let's go back to 2003, where this all started. RUNIX, which I'm guessing means Russian Linux, was based on a fork of UC Linux. UC Linux is intended for microcontrollers without memory management units. Currently, between 2002 and 2018, they were using the 2.0 kernel and the 2.6 kernel and everything in between. PSX Linux, or runnix, is a Linux kernel essentially with no MMU instructions for handling memory. There is already a compiled kernel for the PSX, but there are so many things that are undocumented and historically not kept well during the early 2000s of the internet for this project, apart from what you get on Google Code and the Wayback Machine. And there's a couple of things on the PSX DevNet and a few bits and pieces here and there where people have talked about it, but there's no hard evidence of it actually running. So this video is about checking it out. And I did a little bit of research into how we're going to achieve this, and we're going to start with a serial port cable. This is by far the easiest, fastest and cheapest way to do it, is using a standard serial cable with an ftdi ttl rs232 adapter to your PC, and then you wire it up with three wires, so you only need your RX and your TX and then your ground, and you can pretty much fire up any program and submit it through a terminal. Before we start, the PlayStation 1 memory card is only actually 16 blocks with 8K per block, giving us a total of 128K of real memory. Now, I always thought they were 1 megabyte, but it's actually 1 megabit, which doesn't leave us a lot of room to try and get a file system onto this memory card. With that in mind, let's start the project. So here's today's console. This guy is running a stealth chip inside it, and it's ready to go. And we've got our memory card here with UniROM already pre-installed onto it, so we can pretty much set up our serial port communication as soon as we've finished making up our cable. It's a bit of an old console. This one was actually in the shed, and it doesn't actually have the parallel port, but it's got the serial port here, as you can see, a little bit closer. So that's all we need, technically. So if you've got one of these consoles without a parallel port, this is all you should need. Okay, so let's open this brand new serial cable that I've just purchased. Let's open it up, pull it apart. Look at that. Yep, everything looks fine there. Those pins look great. Plugs in fine, no worries. We'll grab our ftdi usb ttl 232 converter and we'll wire this thing up. I'm probably going to solder it opposed to putting on clips or anything else like that. We've got our unirom cd just in case, and I've got an actual db9 there for another cable that I've actually got here. That should also do it, because this is actually an FTDI cable as well, so it should be able to do it. So I went through, checked the pins, checked them for continuity to make sure everything was fine, and then figured out which ones I needed to map to each location. Now I actually made a mistake here, because while I was correct, you'll see here I've got ground and you can see the TXD on the bottom right hand side there, and then below R1 and VCC is RXD. So those are actually the same as the RX pins and the TX pins that come off the bottom there. So I actually wired them up correctly, RX to RX and TX to TX, but we actually need to talk to these the other way around. So initially what you see here was wrong. And I know you're thinking, like, what an idiot. Obviously transmit talks to receive and receive talks to transmit on either end, but you know, I add these parts to my video so you can understand that not everything's smooth sailing, and even I make mistakes and other people make mistakes too. So we downloaded the PSX serial program and burnt that to a disc, right? So this is sitting here standing by waiting for a serial port command. So I'm running the serial port program from Windows 7 and it's waiting, and I'm sitting there going, what the hell's going on? And I figured, what if I unplug and plug in the adapter, and voila, it started sending packets. And I thought, okay, that's cool, but when you go back to the other screen, it actually shows you that nothing has been sent, even though here it says it was a success. So it's still sitting here, standing by, and nothing has changed. So I knew straight away something was wrong. I'd done something wrong here. All right, so I changed the RX to TX and TX to RX, and I loaded up a game called Airport, and I thought, I'll give this a go, and this should work, and voila, look at that. It's amazing what happens when you've got the wires wired up the right way. So it was receiving and sending its data. It took a little while, so I sped it up here, but you know, 110 packets, and it goes through. But no program loaded. I was a little bit disappointed at this stage, so I don't know what the deal is. That's one of the homebrew games I thought I'd test out first, but it actually looked really cool, Airport. So I tried it with the Linux kernel, receiving data from PC. And this actually took a while to load, because it's a bit more than the 110, I think it's like 300 packets of data needed to be sent and loaded into memory. So you'll see it here in a minute. Oh yes, it finally loaded, and kernel panic. I have no root and I want to scream. Now, I have a theory here that when the Runnix guys were trying to get this to work on this console, they probably ran into a bit of a problem with the file system on the PlayStation memory cards, because they actually use a very similar file system to the FAT file system. I think it is a proprietary Sony version of FAT 16 or 32 or some kind of FAT, VFAT sort of file system, and from what I've read, they actually wanted to use multiple memory cards to build up one file system. Now that's kind of an issue here, and the other issue being the PlayStation 1 only has 2 megabytes of RAM. So what we're going to have to do here is probably recompile our own kernel. We're going to have to change where it's looking for root, or when the any init rd or initrid is located, because we're going to have to, I think the next step is to upgrade the EDO memory. And that's completely possible. A lot of people have been doing this for a while now on the PlayStation 1 for homebrew and other development and all that sort of stuff. But I think if we can get more memory in there, we can run a full RAM disk and get around this whole memory card thing. Because I think they've probably got it going. And I think even if you had an extension 2 or extended ext2 partition, right, I don't think it would even allow it. I mean, a byte size is 128k, you know, for example, and you've only got 128k, so one byte size would be that. Okay, so that's going to do it for this video, guys. I could sit here for a lot longer and show you everything else that I've sort of found. And I've gone through the makefiles and the config files for the kernel and some of the source code. And you know what? I found a very interesting lead that might help us out here, because the missing file for the PSX memory card boot file system that the Runnix guys have or had made doesn't exist anymore. Like, you cannot find it anywhere. But the PSP and I think the PSP Vita also use UC Linux to run on there, so we might be able to borrow some code from there. And I've compared a few things here and there, and I'll go into it in the next video, but I think that's the next step forward, is changing the kernel and changing the way we load our RAM disk file system. So that's it for this video, guys. Thanks for watching, and see you next time.